It's the start of 2024 and it feels like Open RAN has been in the press for a very long time. In this video, we're just going to talk through the very high level concept of Open RAN, and then we'll discuss some of the potential sticking points that are out there in the industry today. So if you look at the diagram, we've got your typical Genoid B represented on screen. So this is our 5G base station, and it connects into the 5G core network using a backhaul transport network of some description. So Open RAN really centers around the notion of a disaggregated Genoid B, where we pull apart the Genoid B into several geographically separate functional components. So collectively, the remote radio unit, the distributed unit, and the centralized unit, they all do the job collectively of the 5G base station, the Genoid B. But we distribute responsibilities in terms of processing across these different entities. We're effectively splitting up the protocol stack and giving different responsibilities to each of these functional elements. The point is they are geographically distributed so you can optimize the way in which you deploy your radio access network. You can pull a lot of compute requirement towards the core network and employ cloud technologies for money saving. So when you do this, we need a new transport network effectively. We need mid-haul connectivity. We need front-haul connectivity as well. And this is all IP transport. So that is the notion of a disaggregated radio access network, or a disaggregated Genoid B, also called centralized RAN. Open RAN adopts this approach, but the idea behind Open RAN is we are not looking here at a single vendor solution. These different functional elements can actually come from different vendors. So from a service provider's perspective, you can pick and choose the best of breed. And the hope is that would drive down pricing because of the increased competition. Open RAN also adds more to this mix though. It adds the notion of RAN intelligent controllers, where we have non-real-time and real-time RICs. So they are designed to use techniques like AI and machine learning to truly optimize our radio access network, and potentially using what's known as RApps and XApps, we bring new services through service development into our radio access network. On top of this, we also have a whole management and orchestration framework, which also comes as part of the ORAN solution, standardized by the ORAN Alliance. So that's just a high level view, but we do have some kind of sticking points and some discussion points to take a look at throughout this video. So we'll start off with whether or not what we're looking at here is a new concept. What have we learned already from the industry? So there's a lot of industry hype surrounding Open RAN, and a lot of the hype's really focuses on the fact that it's a new technology and it's going to bring a myriad of new services and cost savings. So how new is it, is the question. Well, there's a few points to note here. One of the problems we've got with Open RAN is because it is a new concept, it's largely 5G and a little bit of 4G centric. Now, the problem we've got, if we look at this on a worldwide basis, there is still lots and lots of 2G and 3G capability out there, particularly in developing countries. So straight away, your market is a little limited in terms of where you can go with Open RAN in some of these developing countries. We've also got the fact that, well, Open RAN is all cloud native, but it's worth pointing out that cloud native operation is not something new. So service providers have been using cloud technologies for a number of years in their networks. Granted, though, it is new really for the radio access network environment. We've also got this notion of control and user plane separation, which you do see in Open RAN. That centralized unit that I mentioned a moment ago can actually be split into a user plane element and a control plane element. But the fact is, this is not new at all within cellular networks. We first started seeing the split of the control and user plane way back in release 4, when we started to see the MSC broken down into the media gateway control function, or the MSC server, and the media gateway. Since then, we've also seen technologies like CUPS, which is control and user plane separation of EPC nodes, being brought into the 4G core network. And of course, we've got lots of control and user plane separation in the 5G core network as well. So that's not necessarily a new concept, but it is now being applied as part of Open RAN. We've also got this notion of AI and machine learning. It seems to be the buzzword for the industry at the minute. It is definitely set to transform the industry, and there is an opportunity to implement AI and machine learning within our RAN environment. I just mentioned the notion of R and X apps. So these would be running on the non-real-time and the near-real-time RIC. The problem is the industry as a whole just hasn't seen a great deal of development and availability of these X and R apps at this time. So yes, it is a new concept. Open RAN is a new concept for the radio access network, but just take from this, there's a lot of techniques that have been introduced that we've seen already in our cellular networks. The next area to consider, which is a bit of a myth potentially at this time, are the cost implications of Open RAN. So there's plenty of sources that will cite the fact that Open RAN can offer maybe OPEX and CAPEX savings of 30 to 40%. Now, the reality is there is just not enough evidence out there to support this claim. And the reason I say that is because the number of live Open RAN deployments that are out there today is a very small proportion of the overall radio access network technologies. We've got to remember that there is a lot of 5G that's already been deployed using the traditional method. Only a small portion of the existing 5G radio access network infrastructure is actually based on Open RAN. The plus point is that there's some very big players in the industry, some very big operators over in North America, for example, that have deployed Open RAN. So there's a lot of press surrounding that. But as mentioned, there's just not enough evidence because there's not enough installed base of technology. And the general point that a lot of people make in the industry about Open RAN is the fact that if you're running a network which consists of technologies that come from a wide number of vendors, generally speaking, that will cost more money. We've got to factor in things like integration costs with all of those different vendors to make them operate together. We've got to factor in lots and lots of separate financial agreements that will be in place. So generally speaking, from industry experience, that costs more money. The next area, the notion of creating a competitive market. So with this distributed vendor agnostic architecture that we're looking at with Open RAN, competition between vendors is supposed to increase, coupled with innovation as well, which is absolutely critical. Well, the reality is if you look at the big vendors that are out there that are traditionally in the radio access network space, they have Open RAN solutions on offer. They are effectively still a single vendor solution. And the question is, are they truly interoperable? So if you did want to mix and match other vendors, would they actually interoperate? The next question, solution providers. So what we're seeing in the industry today is effectively operators that have deployed successfully an Open RAN network, imparting their knowledge to other operators around the world for a fee. And the problem we've got is effectively blueprints for Open RAN solutions are being sold. Now, this blueprint for an Open RAN solution is pretty prescriptive. It will say, these are the vendors that we will use for this particular Open RAN solution, which kind of defeats the object of Open RAN. We seem to be heading towards a different kind of single vendor solution if we have to follow these prescriptive blueprints. So it's not really truly that fully competitive architecture that we're hoping for. It's just a different kind of vendor lock-in. The final point is a really important point, is research and research budgets. The fact is that the big players in the RAN space have a lot more money to spend on research, which will give them naturally a competitive advantage. If you are a smaller vendor wanting to provide capabilities in a niche area of the Open RAN solution, then your budget for research and innovation is a lot smaller. So there is a question over how much innovation Open RAN can actually realistically foster. The final point we've got is an often additional discussed point, which is the notion of Open RAN security. Some people will vehemently defend the security of Open RAN, and then there's some real heavy critics of Open RAN security that are out there. So what is the argument for Open RAN security? Well, the main argument for Open RAN security to say, yes, it is a secure environment, is the fact, the very fact that it is open. So because all of your interfaces are open, they are open to the wider cryptographic community. They are not a kind of closed vendor proprietary solution or anything like that. Everything's open. Everything's open for crypto analysis, and therefore it should be more secure in terms of identifying potential vulnerabilities. That's an argument for, but the arguments against are quite compelling as well. And there's really two main arguments which are against Open RAN security. The first one is really indisputable. The fact is that if you've got a distributed multi-vendor solution, your attack surface is increased, and there's no arguing against that. Your attack surface is increased. And the problem is, with lots and lots of different vendor solutions in your overall Open RAN solution, you're only as secure as your weakest vendor. So if one of those vendors has a chink in the armor, then you're going to have a problem. The other area that's worth discussing is the notion of Chinese equipment manufacturers. We know that governments around the world have been forcing service providers to remove Chinese equipment vendors from their network. But it's worth pointing out that in terms of the contributing bodies to Open RAN, there's a lot of Chinese influence. So there's a lot of different Chinese vendors who do have an actual say in what goes on in, for example, the Open RAN Alliance and the standards. There's a lot of code being developed by Chinese manufacturers. So that in and of itself is perhaps a security consideration. So we've got four key areas there in terms of just questions that are being asked about Open RAN. And just to conclude, just a few more points for you to consider. The first one is the standards bodies. So the main standards body is the Open RAN Alliance, and some question whether or not enough is being done in the standards space, particularly to assist with the likes of XApp and RApp developers. We've also got the 3GPP involved, because 3GPP standards are part of ORAN's, or the ORAN Alliance's solution. We've got this big question over whether or not Open RAN will actually stimulate the services market. And again, we're talking about the services that might be made available as a result of deploying Open RAN solutions. So some of the optimization techniques and such, like mobility tracking, etc., being developed as part of RAN type services. The question is, are they going to appear? Because we're not seeing a great deal of it in the industry to date. The other question is, will Open RAN, or something like it, be the approach taken for 6G? And the question really will be answered in the coming years. If we do indeed see a huge proliferation of Open RAN technology, then the chances are we'll see it deployed in 6G. Yes, we will undoubtedly be seeing a centralized RAN or a distributed base station type approach. It's just whether or not we see everything else related to Open RAN. Another question which has to be answered is the efficiency in terms of energy consumption of Open RAN. There's some say that just the very fact that you are not using specialized chips in Open RAN, so you could be using commercial off-the-shelf hardware, yes, it may be cost-saving, but is it energy efficient enough? Whereas if you're using more specialized chips, you will get the benefits, particularly in terms of energy, amongst many others. Is there enough incentive for R and XApp designers? We've got to think about the installed base of Open RAN technology as it stands today. Is there enough out there for XApp and RApp organisations, development organisations, to actually take an interest. And then finally, and crucially, right at the start of this session, we talked about the notion of front haul, back haul, and in between mid haul. These are all separate transport networks. And as we distribute our architecture to be in line with the Open RAN concept, are the transport networks up to the job? Do we have enough optical and microwave transmission there to fulfill the requirement for Open RAN? The answer is probably not. As we see things like cell densification and the use of millimeter wave increasingly being used out there, well, we need a lot more IP transport to consider. So we've got a number of other questions that need answering. The general consensus in the industry today is there's a big question mark over Open RAN, and time will tell, particularly in the coming years, exactly how successful the concept will be.